Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite everyone on the today last part of our conference titled Rebellion Cities in the Eastern Bloc. I have a great honor of greeting our guests who arrived to us from a different part of the world. We have a guest who came to us from Scotland, from Germany, from the Czech Republic, and from Georgia. Ladies and gentlemen, as we know, the communist Poland wasn't in a vacuum. So in consequence, it wasn't the only place in the Eastern Bloc where the public protests exploded. Just a minute, we will hear the addresses which will be concerning the workers' rebellion of different kind in the other communist countries. I suppose that we will know the causes, the course, and of course the consequences. Just before the start, I have a big request to our guests. We must follow the predicted time for the individual paper. I will be announcing of you when the 5 minute and the 1 minute stayed until the end of delivering a paper. So let's start, I think. Let me introduce our first speaker. It's Professor Hermann Wendker from the Institute of Contemporary History in Munich and Berlin. Research interests of Professor Wendker are focused around the history of the international relations in the 19th and the 20th century, and of course the history of German Democratic Republic. I will present or describe a few most important books from huge achievement of our guest from Germany. So for example, Foreign Policy Within Narrow Limits, the German Democratic Republic in the International System from 1949 to 1989, Munich 2007, or Coedition with Dirk Hoffmann, The Last Year of the Soviet Occupation Zone, Policy Orientations and Continuity in the Process of Establishment of the German Democratic Republic, Munich 2000. Mr. Professor Hermann Wendker will present the paper to us under the title The Berlin Uprising of 1953. Mr. Professor.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation to this interesting conference. Thank you very much for your nice introduction. The uprising of 1953 in the GDR was one of the first mass upheavals in the Eastern Bloc. It encompassed not only Berlin, but the whole of the East German state. Strikes and demonstrations took place in over 700 towns and municipalities. Up to 1 million people participated in the mass protests. But as we are looking at rebellious cities in the Eastern Bloc in a comparative perspective, I will concentrate on the events in East Berlin. On the one hand, these were in some ways typical for the whole upheaval. That means a large number of its dimensions are to be found in other parts of the GDR as well. And East Berlin thus can be regarded as a pars pro toto. On the other hand, I will try to point out to the specifics of the uprising in Berlin, which was not a city like any other. It had been the former German capital, its eastern sector was the capital of the GDR, and it was divided between East and West, but still accessible from all sides. So in my following remarks, I will first look briefly at the causes of the uprising and give a short chronology of events in Berlin. Second, I'm going to ask what was specific for the uprising in this city. And third, I will deal with facets which were typical for the uprising in general. First, causes and course of the uprising in the GDR and Berlin. In 1953, the GDR found itself in a self-induced deep economic and financial crisis. In July 1952, the second party conference of the SED had adopted a crash socialization and collectivization program, which included a massive armaments program and a build-up of armed forces. Economically, this meant a concentration on the expansion of heavy industries with negative effects on other branches of the economy and the agriculture, which was put under additional strain by collectivization. This meant that the population was no longer adequately supplied with food and other consumer goods. The other side of socialization was an intensification of class struggle from above, which hit especially the middle class. Moreover, this meant an intensification of the build-up of the East German dictatorship with campaigns against restive social organizations, especially the churches with their youth groups. Mass repressions and a tightening up of criminal justice filled the GDR's prisons and led to mass emigration into the Federal Republic. From January to June 1953, over 195,000 people fled from the GDR. After Stalin's death in March 1953, the new Soviet leadership decided on a new course for all satellites, including the GDR. The SED leadership was ordered to Moscow and returned with a program which took back most of the measures the party conference of July 1952 had decided on. This new course, proclaimed in the GDR on June the 10th, 1953, however, had one blank space. It did not contain any concessions towards the workers whose production norms had been raised in May by an average of 10%. This is probably due to the fact that the document handed over to the SED leaders in Moscow had not enlarged on this problem. The East German population interpreted the new course as a sign of weakness. Therefore, to them, it seemed not unlikely that the leadership would give way to demands calling for taking back the norm increase as well. The uprising took Berlin as its point of departure. On June the 15th, workers of the construction site for the hospital Friedrichshain decided to stop work and send a delegation to Minister President Otto Grotewohl to deliver a petition to rescind the norm increases. An answer was expected by the next day. The delegates were received by two of Grotewohl's assistants, but left without any assurances concerning their demands. News of the strike quickly spread to other building sites, which also stopped work in the course of the afternoon. Workers on Block 40 in Stalin Allee were told that next day a central trade union representative would be there to speak to them. Instead of this, a member of the local trade union came on the morning of June the 16th and pointed out to an article in the union paper of the same day, restating the necessity of the norm increase. This was the drop that made the barrel overflow. 500 workers stopped work, marched out of the construction site, were joined by others, and marched to the city center. Their main demand was the reduction of the norms. Outside the GDR House of Ministries, the crowd demanded to speak to Ulbricht and Grotewohl. In the end, only heavy industry minister Fritz Zeltmann came out. He tried to make himself heard, but was shouted down at a worker declared, quote, "We want to be free. Our demonstration is not only directed against the norms. We are not only from Stalin Allee, but from the whole of Berlin. This is an uprising of the people. We demand a free and secret ballot." After this incident, a general strike was called for June the 17th, although in the meantime, the norm increase had been taken back. The crowd dispersed, but in the night, the riots continued. The SED called for an extraordinary gathering, a Parteiaktivtagung, where Grotewohl and Ulbricht spoke in defense of the new course, but only half-heartedly conceded that mistakes had been made. They seemed to believe that with the rescission of the norm increase, the cause for the unrest had been removed and that the situation would again be under control. They could not have been more mistaken. According to the call for action, on June the 17th, most workers in Berlin stopped work, all in all, almost 40,000. Moreover, more than 10,000 people gathered between 6 and 7 a.m. on Strausberger Platz, near Alexanderplatz, and on other places in the city center. In the course of a few hours, the masses increased to about 150,000. Many of them had come from the industrial city quarters, but also from places outside Berlin. Police forces assigned to control the demonstrations failed miserably. There were not enough of them, they did not have the right instructions, and they were uncertain about the employment of guns. On midday, the actions escalated. Demonstrators tried to storm the police headquarters and managed, for a short time, to get access to the House of Ministries. But at 1 p.m., the Soviet commandant declared a state of emergency over Berlin, and the uprising was crushed by Soviet tanks. Now guns were employed, but the Soviets did not create a bloodbath among the protesters. Some 13 Berliners lost their lives in the course of the day. One, Willy Göttling, was executed by the Soviets on June the 18th. That was the end of the mass demonstrations, but not the end of the uprising. The strikes on the construction sites and in industrial plants continued in Berlin for two or three more days, in other parts of the GDR even longer. A last wave of unrest occurred in the middle of July when workers of the Buna works near Halle and the Zeiss works in Jena went on strike again. That leads me to the second point, the characteristic features of the Berlin uprising. Now, why was Berlin the starting point of the uprising? And why were the builders the first to protest? Builders were, compared with other workers, relatively well off. But one has to take into account that they had to earn enough money during spring, summer, and autumn to get them through the winter when they were out of work. So they were dependent on fairly good pay. And an increase of work norms meant, of course, a reduction of wages. The other, often neglected fact we have to bear in mind is that in divided Berlin, the standard of living in the West was higher than in the East. Some 40,000 people, mostly workers, living in East Berlin but working in the West, were permanently confronted with this fact. Moreover, in West Berlin, one branch of workers in the building business, the plasterers, had been on strike from May to June, and they had been successful. This showed workers in East Berlin what was possible in the West and must have increased their discontent considerably. A second specific aspect of the uprising in Berlin was RIAS, the radio in the American sector. Some of its programs were especially made for East Berliners or GDR citizens who informed themselves via this medium about what was going on in their own country. At the time of the uprising, RIAS did not want to add fuel to the fire. The only instruction which reached RIAS was, quote, to do nothing that could provoke the Soviets. Although RIAS itself did not call upon workers in the East to strike, they reported about what was happening in the East. And when a delegation of builders from East Berlin came to RIAS in the evening of June the 16th, they were not allowed to issue their call to strike themselves, but in the news broadcast in the evening, 4 points of the workers' resolution were read out. Namely, first, wages should be paid according to the old norms. Secondly, immediate cut in the costs of living. Third, free and secret ballots. Fourth, no sanctions against striking workers or their spokesmen. This was not the only way and not the only radio station by which news of the strike and the demands of the protesters spread in East Berlin and the GDR, but it was a very important way, which underlines the role of Berlin as a starting point and center of the uprising in the whole country. The third aspect is that a large number of participants in the upheaval came from West Berlin. In spite of the division into four sectors, Berliners still felt as citizens of one city. One way of manifesting their protest was to set fire to the sentry shelters and to destroy the signs for the borders between the sectors. Moreover, 40,000 West Berliners working in the East had to endure a special hardship. From March 1953, they no longer received their wages, which had to be transferred to a special account of the East Berlin magistrate. As they had not been formally dismissed, they were not entitled to unemployment aid in the West, which made things very difficult for them. How many West Berliners participated in the uprising is not clear. In a Soviet report, it was estimated that they were about 10,000, but the figure seems a bit low. The fourth point is that West Berlin was not a zone separating the GDR and East Berlin, but a zone of communication and thoroughfare. This did not only become clear in the context of RIAS, but also when strikes started in all regions of Brandenburg around Berlin. In Henningsdorf, northwest of Berlin, on June the 16th, steel workers stopped work. In the morning of June the 17th, these workers decided to join the protests in the city center. Although the French commander initially did not want to let them through, they marched all the 27 kilometers until they joined the protesters. On their way, they were supported by West Berliners. After the uprising, West Berlin became an area of retreat for the demonstrators, although they were hindered by the fact that the Soviets closed the borders to the West. That leads me to the third point, general aspects of the uprising, Berlin as pars pro toto. Points of departure of the uprising of 1953 in East Berlin and the GDR were large enterprises and large building sites. We normally have the pattern that first there was a work stoppage, followed by a strike, and in the end, workers left their working area for demonstrations in the city. This did not have to be the case, but one overall impression remains. Workers were the main agents of the uprising, in the workplaces as well as in the streets, even if the protest leaders often lost control over the masses after leaving the plants. The fact that industrial workers were the main agents of the uprising had a number of implications. First, in large enterprises, a leading strike committee was formed, mostly not by formal election, but by acclamation. Often, older, respected workers were elected. Sometimes, as in a plant in Berlin-Köpenick, an engineer could also come into such a position. The aim of this proceeding was to reach an orderly process of the protests. In some parts of the GDR, but not in Berlin, strike committees encompassing several industrial plants were formed with the aim of preventing riots. Second, workers had maintained their specific culture of striking and protesting. They resumed traditions of the German Social Democrats and the free trade unions. This meant that they sang workers' songs, carried red flags with them, and demanded that the official trade unions should at last represent their interests. And because of this specific protest culture, strikes and conflicts in the industrial plants went on for a long time after the upheaval in the streets had been crushed by Soviet tanks. Third, because of the leading role workers played in the upheaval, the key areas of the uprising were Berlin and the industrial areas in the middle and the southern regions of the GDR. Besides the workers, other parts of the population joined in the demonstrations and protests outside the enterprises. The so-called intelligence was heterogeneous. White-collar workers and the technical intelligence in the industrial plants sometimes remained passive, others showed solidarity with the workers. Teachers mainly remained neutral, university staff as well. Other people joined the marches of the protesters or took action. Housewives, young people, members of the middle class. Housewives had experienced that the standard of living had decreased rapidly and that they had not been able to take care of the needs of their families. Youngsters were very active in the streets, especially in the riots that ensued in some places, but they also protested in school against compulsory Russian lessons and left the state youth organization. Although workers played the main part and initiated the protests, the upheaval became in due course a Volksaufstand, an uprising of the people. As the uprising began, because of the increase of work norms, the first protesters on June the 16th carried a banner saying, "We builders want norm reduction." But very quickly, such demands concerning social needs mingled with political demands. The reason for this is clear. Everybody knew that the devastating economic situation was a result of the regime's disastrous political decisions. So anyone wanting other social conditions had to stick up at least for another policy, even for another political system. Demands for better living conditions were sometimes combined with political demands. We want butter instead of cannons. The social demands encompassed reduction or complete abolition of work norms, price reductions, reduction of wages for the police and for the so-called intelligence. The political protests turned directly against the GDR leadership and the GDR institutions deemed unnecessary. Down with the hunger government, away with the goatee, meaning Ulbricht with his characteristic beard, dissolution of the official trade union apparat, and we don't need a people's army. Furthermore, the protesters demanded liberation of political prisoners and free elections. And the demand for free elections was almost always directly connected with the demand for the re-establishment of German unity, which could be explicitly stated or implicitly formulated, for example, by calling for the abolition of the zonal borders in Germany or by singing the national anthem. This leads us to the question how peaceful or violent the protests were. The strike leaders intended to strike peacefully. A leader of the uprising in Dresden, Wilhelm Grothaus, appealed to the protesters, "As German workers, we want to strike peacefully." People like him organized a kind of security service to ensure that the demonstrators did not do any damage. But with the mingling of other parts of the population with the workers and the increase of the protesting masses, the crowds no longer could be kept under control. Outbursts of violence were directed against propaganda banners, against pictures of Stalin and SED leaders, and against propaganda kiosks, which were set on fire. Moreover, they were directed against prisons, where demonstrators wanted to free political prisoners. If the guards capitulated, nothing happened to them. If they did not, fighting could normally follow. The crowds also tried to storm the bastilles of power, SED houses, Stasi offices, police buildings. In the course of these fights, representatives of the regime could be wounded or killed, but violence against things was much more widespread than violence against persons. This also reflects the fact that the uprising was of spontaneous character and did not aim at taking over the government. There was no plan behind the uprising, and there were no national leaders. Because of this, the Soviets could quell the open protests in the streets quite quickly. The Soviet troops did not intend to produce a bloodbath either. The tanks rolling through Berlin and other cities in the GDR did not shoot. They had the task to deter the people. At some places, courageous demonstrators tried to fight back with stones, but not with great success. And although the regime had in the beginning been skeptical if their own police and military forces could be trusted, there was hardly any fraternization with the protesters. And in crushing the uprising, the GDR security forces cooperated well with the Soviet military. Between 13,000 and 15,000 people were arrested in the GDR. A large number were set free after a short time, but others were tried and convicted, partly by Soviet military tribunals, SMT, partly by East German courts. The SMT convicted 18 people to death and between 500 and 750 persons to long prison sentences in the Soviet Gulag, especially in Vorkuta.
1 minute, please.
The East German courts were, taking into account the state order of the GDR had almost been overthrown, relatively lenient in their verdicts. All in all, about 1,800 were convicted, two of them to death, three to lifelong imprisonment, and the rest to shorter prison sentences. East German courts and the Stasi did their jobs, but they were not able to fulfill their most important task, to find out and try the Western originators of the uprising, because that was what the SED had said was the cause, the Western originators. This was no wonder, because these people only existed in the minds of the SED leadership, who did not want to admit that the uprising of 1953, which had almost resulted in the downfall of the GDR, had to be attributed to their own mistaken policy. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Professor. As we heard, the Berlin uprising closed with defeat, of course, and the death of many people. However, it was first so serious rebellion of the working class in the country where the working class was supposed to be the most important and was supposed to rule first.
The first one was in Pilsen. In 1950, in spring 1953.
So one of the first.
As Mr. Blažek will tell you.
Okay, so one of the first. But a few years later, the Poles and the Hungarians went the same way, and Professor Cilia Kis will tell us about the Hungarian uprising 3 years later. Let me introduce the Professor Kis. Professor Kis came from us from the University of Aberdeen. Ms. Professor studied in Canada, but she was also a visiting student in the University of Oxford. Moreover, on the educational path of Ms. Professor, we can find also universities in Hungary, Lajos Kossuth University in Debrecen and Central European University in Budapest. The part of interest for Ms. Professor includes the politics of the memory in Hungary and the matter of settlements with the Stalinists. When it comes to the publication of Professor Kis, I will present just the few last publications from the extensive academic achievements of Professor Kis. So, for example, Divided Memory in Hungary, The House of Terror, and The Lack of the Left Wing Narrative in Simona Mitru edition, Life, Writing, and Politics of Memory in Eastern Europe is the book chapter. For example, journal articles, We Must Remember Thus, Traditional Justice in Service of Memory in Hungary, Studia Universitatis Sibiniensis. Okay, you have 20 minutes.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. and thank you for everyone who is still here. So this is very interesting to talk about 1956, because now we are celebrating the anniversary of the protest in Radom, but at the same time, this October, we are going to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the 1956 uprising. And in a way, it is very much related to the Polish events. Among the preceding events of the uprising, I think everybody knows the death of Stalin, of course the example of the uprising in East Berlin in 1953, and then the Khrushchev speech at the 20th Congress of the Soviet Communist Party, and the discovery or uncovering of the crimes of Stalin, and the prime ministership of Imre Nagy in 1953, and then his later demotion. The most important actors in the before the uprising were, first of all, intellectuals in a way, the Writers Association and the Petőfi Circle, which was pretty much a debating community, debating society, people discussing, mainly intellectuals discussing the issues a need for change in the Stalinist regime. And on the other hand, some of the actors were the party opposition around Imre Nagy, the demoted previous prime minister. And of course, the Polish events were very important because the demonstration and the uprising learned a lot from the Polish events. Another very significant event was the funeral of László Rajk, the communist victim of the show trial in 1949, and his funeral was very important and demanded by his widow, saying, if you had a show trial, you must have a show funeral as well, and it took place on the 6th of October. So you can see, not long before the uprising actually happened. Now, the uprising itself was very much inspired by the Polish events in Poznan. In fact, many of the slogans referred to the Polish example, saying that if we want communism, it has to be some kind of Hungarian way, national communism, not the Stalinist version. Now on the map, you can see, okay, this is not going to work, you can see most of the sites of the uprising, of the demonstration in Budapest. It was organized by students of the Technical University and also by the Petőfi Circle. And you can see that it was pretty much in the inner city of Budapest, up there at the statue of Joseph Bem, and down there at the statue of Sándor Petőfi, a big hero of the 1848 revolution in Hungary. And if you look at that red line, interestingly enough, it became the usual route for the Hungarian demonstrations during the 70s, during the rule of János Kádár. So, not particularly because of the 56 reference, but because this is very convenient to march there and have a presence there in the city. You can see some of the main locations, which of course became very significant sites in Budapest, the statue of Joseph Bem, the statue of Petőfi, and then the building of parliament, where Imre Nagy gave a demanded speech, which, and that I think is well known, that he was demanded to speak, he was expected to turn things, turn the communist regime into some kind of acceptable rule. And he went out to the balcony of parliament, he started his speech saying, comrades, and the mob or the multitude of people responded, "We are not comrades." And then he was a bit taken aback, and then he changed into Hungarians. Now the demonstration organized by Petőfi Circle and the Writers Association had approximately 100,000-200,000 people, so you can imagine it was a huge demonstration, and in fact it was so big that the organizers lost control of it. They didn't know how to handle it. The other important location there was the Hungarian radio, which I will talk about a little bit more, and of course the Stalin statue on the Hősök tere location, where people went there and basically dismantled the statue of Joseph Stalin, got rid of it, took it off its of the stone, and at the same time they cut it into little pieces. Now, what is, like I said before, it was mainly a demonstration by students, by people from the inner city, which I was showing before, which you can see there. And according to some people, it became more chaotic and more radical when at the Western railway station, I marked it with red, the workers who came from the outer districts met the students at the demonstration. Now, one of the very significant events of the uprising of that night, of course, besides the dismantlement of the Stalin statue and besides the speech of Imre Nagy, was at the in front of the Hungarian radio, where the demonstrators wanted to read out, wanted to broadcast their 16 points, their demands, and they were stalled, they were misled, people pretended that they are broadcasting the points without having done that, which also shows the uncertainty and the inability of the party leaders to decide what to do, how to handle the situation. This was actually shown throughout the day. First they wanted to prohibit the demonstration, then they decided it should go on, but it should not be broadcast, it should not be stopped. In the end, all this shows that we don't know, and I think it's still not really known, who actually ended up shooting at the radio. Some people say it was some of the demonstrators, other people say that it was most likely those Secret Service officers and policemen who were ordered to go there and defend the radio. And that actually unleashed a chain of events, because people from there went to the Kilian barracks. You can see there Kilian, I think it's legible, to get ammunition. At the same time, they also relieved the police officers of their weapons and ammunition, and at the same time, the workers were those, and that's why it is so important that they joined the protest. They knew which factory had weapons, which factory had significant ammunition. So basically, these were the most important sites, and for the rest of the almost 2 weeks, it was very important what kind of role the uprising actually had. These are just some of the most important locations. Kilian barracks, that's where they went for ammunition, and the leader, the commander of the barrack, Palmaléter, actually joined the uprising and started supporting them. And here you can see some of the main sites of the armed uprising. Now that is quite interesting because, like I said, the first demonstration had 100, 200,000 people. But then those people who were participants in front of the radio, participants in dismantling the Stalin statue, for the rest of the time mainly went home, looked on, tried to hide, and those who were actually participating in the armed uprising itself were around 10, 15,000 people. And they were mainly young people. It's very important that those people who lived in Budapest during the war and actually lived through the siege of Budapest did not go out to take part in the uprising because they pretty well knew that it was impossible, it was hopeless. These sites were organized more or less spontaneously in order to fight against those who were trying to protect the Stalinist rule and at the same time against the first Soviet attack, which happened at the night of October 23. And what they were doing was what actually you can call city guerrilla, and some people claim that they knew how to do it from the films they were seeing or from their military training in school. Other people claim that that wouldn't be much help, especially in terms of urban guerrilla. What they were doing basically, and you can see that I tried to underline or circle some of the most important places there. They were usually not attacking the Russians, and later on, when the Russians stopped the first attack, then the defenders of the Stalinist order, what they were doing was basically using Molotov cocktails, looking out for tanks, and then defending one district or one building, actually, which was very easy in Budapest because it was it had small streets and tall buildings. Now, an interesting thing here is that some historians would say that where we see the main sites of the uprising, of the armed fights, are the outskirts of Budapest. In fact, all those things would today be looked at as parts of the inner city. Of course, it wasn't in the middle of Budapest around the Danube, but all those sites are regarded today as the inner city, and there are more important, and there are some, I think, some good pictures of where the previous was the Korvinkert. That's a very famous and long-lasting site around the cinema there. And then there are, you can actually see here how the landscape changed during the uprising from day to day, and then how it was later on rebuilt during the Kádár regime. And Tűzoltó Street, another very important site of the uprising, led by that guy, István Angyal, later executed during the reprisals of the Kádár regime. And it's very interesting because he was a survivor of Auschwitz and at the same time a dedicated leftist, a dedicated communist, who was actually on November the 7th flying the red flag on the barricade in order to show that they are the true workers and the true revolutionaries, not the Stalinist forces. And I think that's quite important because in general, it can be claimed that none of the 1956 programs consisted of anything more than a revival, a reformation of the socialist system. They wanted to do away with Stalinism, but they did not want to return to the interwar period, quasi-feudalism, and they were not interested in reestablishing private property, so to speak. When it seemed, and in that respect, they were pretty much in sync with the with the government of Imre Nagy, and therefore they thought that he was their prime minister who could actually fulfill their demands, and in that respect, the accusations against the uprising that it was fascist and it wanted to reestablish Nazism or the interwar period were actually false. The only important dissenting voice was said, was heard on the 3rd of November by Cardinal Mincenti, who claimed that Imre Nagy was an inheritor of the fallen system, and he wanted to reestablish some kind of private property regime and some kind of more role for the church. In that respect, it is said that those people from the Christian national middle class who might have supported him woke up very late. By that time, the Soviet tanks were there on the night of November the 4th, and therefore it can be argued that with that, Hungary was at the threshold of a potential divided society, a potential civil war, but of course it could never manifest because of the Soviet attack. Now, of course, the Soviet attack didn't solve everything immediately. There were important fights pretty much till the 10th of November, partly because the first attack went against the inner city, so the more outer districts could survive a little bit more. You can, I think, see here that I try to circle, there is the inner city which was attacked first, and then some of the outskirts could regroup and organize some kind of defense. Now they were actually, Pest Erzsébet was an important place, and the whole uprising and the armed revolt, armed defense, has been researched pretty much by that guy, László Őrsi, and then there are some other places where you can see how the fights went. The final, the last place to fall was on November the 10th, Csepel. Now, a few words about the afterlife of the uprising, because everybody felt that people accepted the Kádár regime and the consolidation and the Soviet victory very fast. And in fact, if we look at the constitution and the composition of people, many people did not join in for political reasons, for political purposes. They joined for because of the low living standards, the low salaries, the high norms, what you've heard already. Therefore, as long as Kádár, according to some historians, had this kind of brittle legitimacy, which means that as long as he managed to keep up the living standards of the workers, they accepted him and they more or less supported the regime as being better than all the other regimes. And if you look at these pictures, you can also see how the Kádár was trying to rebuild the city, rebuild the those parts of the city which were really damaged during the uprising, in order, and in that respect, while otherwise he was following other kind of architecture, here he really tried to do it as close to the original as possible in order to if possible, get rid of the memories of the revolution or of the uprising. There are things I wanted to say about the memory, the current memory of the uprising and how it had been treated by Kadar and by the post-communist system, but I think we can talk about it tomorrow in the panel. So basically, I want to finish with these two books, one written in the 1970s, the other written 5-6 years ago, because both books kind of Metropole in a clandestine way, Spiro in a very direct way, have this kind of sadness, disappointment about the way people in the end forgot 56 and decided to move on with their lives. And that was also a shock for people who came out of prison in the 1960s and found a consolidated society. And I think it's an important memory for Hungarian history, both the event and the afterlife of the event. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Because, of course, we are in Poland, maybe we should add and emphasize that the Polish society reacted very emotionally to events in Hungary. Even Polish authorities didn't find anti-revolutionary action in Hungarian uprising. We know about the Polish society, about the spontaneous help of Poles for Hungarian, of course. But when it comes to authorities, the other situation, a different situation, was in 1968, when Władysław Gomułka, the first secretary of the Polish United Workers' Party, was one of the main adherents of radical action against the Czechoslovakia. And of course, the Polish army took part in the armed intervention in this country. And I think that Peter Blażek knows very well about it. Let me introduce you, Peter Blażek. He came to us from the Institute for the Study of Totalitarian Regimes in Prague. Dr. Blażek published a book about Ryszard Siwiec, a Polish citizen who committed self-immolation in a Warsaw stadium on September 1968 in a protest against the August occupation of Czechoslovakia, but armies of Warsaw Pact countries, and of course, and the participation of the Polish troops of that invasion. Peter Blażek will tell us about the Prague in 1968. You have 20 minutes.
Dziękuję bardzo.
Proszę bardzo.
Szanowni panie, szanowni panowie, dziękuję serdecznie organizatorom za zaproszenie na niniejszą konferencję. Poszczególnie wystąpienie potwierdzają tezę, że historię bloku sowieckiego należy postrzegać jako długi ciąg kryzysów, które przychodzili i odchodzili z taką samą regularnością jak kolejne plany pięcioletnie. W zasadzie ciężko odpowiedzieć na pytanie, czy najpierw następowali kryzysy, či průběh reform. Tématem nynějšího referátu jsou vydařeně Čechoslovácké z konce 80. spolně s vengerskými povstáním z roku 1056 polským karnevalem Solidarnosti z počátku let 80. i koncovou fáze istnění pak sovětika na přelome let 80. i 90. 20. věku postřegáne jako jeden z hlavních krizisů vevnitř bloku sovětského. Ty vydařeně přišly v přelomovém roku 68. přelomovým tím, že protestovali lidi na celém světě. Je to bardzo dobře zbadaný témat, přičinili se do tego značný stupni i historici polsky. Najčeštěji chyba pražská věsna z 68. roku okrošlona je jako pierša odgórně kierovaná průba reform systému komunističného přeprovádzania bez učekáňa še do přemoci. Teza taká připisuje klučovou role kierovnictvu partii komunističnej, jednak při dokladnějším oglondě jest ona zbyt mlista. Vyjašnění také neodpověďa zluženosti u včesných vydaření historičných procesů i vzájemných relací. Důvod zo tego včonž živé všrut českých historiků spory interpretacíjné, v kterých jedním z hlavních činníků uružňujících je strola odnovioného společenstva obyvatelského oraz to sunek vlad komunističných do těch nových form aktivnosti společných. Najkvěnkšou, jak doto diskuzie vyvolal, vydaný před ponad 15 lety monumentální sbor archiválních dokumentů přigotovaný přes historiků z Institutu historii najnovšej Akademii nauk Republiky České, kterým přichovivání jest archivum bendonce vynikem prác panstvovej komisi badajonce už po úpadku systému komunističného vydeřenia z konca let 60. Publikace ta zavírala mezi jinými odpisy dokumentů archiválních dokumentujících role odgryváno přes KPČ v okreše pomenzi májem i šerpněm 68. roku. Vydavci užili vůvčas jak po titulu termín konsolidácia. Hočanč byl on už v češně vykořistivány po všechně v odněšení do vydařeň po šerpnových. V tým novým ujenčů konsolidácia měla označit paralelný program partii komunističnej, bendoncí jej jiným niž po všechně známé obličem, které začalo še ujavnit do Pierov oparčů o vevnitřné dokumenty partijné. Program ten vedl k autorův zbioru nebyl jedině reakcou kierovnictva KPČ na nevybředné načišky vyvěrané přes Związek Radzieckich Sojuzników. Načišky te pojavily se už krutce po objenču kierovničego stanovisko přes Alexandra Dubčeka i naši Liliše po slinném spotkání v Drežni v marcu 68. roku. Po zebrání KC KPČ v květnu v 68. roku kierovnictvo partijné z vlastní iniciativy zdecidovalo, že nie na poglemnění reform, ale radšej na ich dokladně přečivěnstvo. Hlavním problémem stalo se utřímání kontroly nad odnovioným společenstvem obyvatelským. Navěd přijetý v květnu 68. roku program Dželan KPČ nelíčil se s likvidáciou kierovničej roli partii komunističnej i političného systému Frontu Narodového, v kterým pozostalé partie odgryvály role poslušných satelitů. Vydávci tomu stvrdili, že kierovnictvo Dubčeka ružnilo še radšej v kvěsti tego, kedy i v jaký způsob oglošit společenstvu, že žádné reformy nebudou předprovidzané, niž v kvěstiach programových či koncepcijných. Nepřevidívalo vše žádného překstalčáňa krajů v pánstvo demokratičné. Dopušťáno myšlo o jakéž formě demokratizací i vyznačení na novo granic akceptovatelných zachování společných. Čenč účastníků chtěla oglosit to ještě před zjazdem, zas v čenč zakladala, že lepším rozvězáním bude oglošení těch informací už po zjaždě. Problematičná je rovněž sama názva Pražská věsna 68. roku, poněvadž ograničá ona vydaření za rovno pod zglindem časovým, jak i přestřeným. V řečivistosti krizi s režimu komunističného dával vše za observovač ne tylko v stolici, ale zasádě ve všech regionách. Odejště Antonína Novotného z funkce prvšího sekretáře KC KPČ mělo věle příčin, všrut kterých kvestia k Slovácka odegrala istotnou vládzi. Role. Antonín Novotný už po 60. roku zmocnil v oparču o novou konstitucie centralizácie vládzi. Provádzil tež dlugofalovo politike přečivstavání vše slováckým ambiciom narodovým. V tým samým čase všedl v konflikt s prvším sekretářem KC partii komunističnej Slováci Alexandrem Dubčekem, který ostatečně stal se jeho hlavním riválem a po palacovém převrotě z roku 1968 jeho nástemcou. Obecně dost problematičným krokem je ograničení pražské věsny jedině do kilka měšonci roku 1968 ličoncích odspomínané před chvílou vymíjany ekipy řondžoncej ze stýčna 68. roku až po šerpňovou invázie, která označala šilové rozvězání krizisu přeprovádzaně analogičně do vydaření vengerských. Podejště také neumožlivá bověn zrozumění širšího kontextu vydaření i dlouhotrvalých procesů, které zdeterminovaly ogulné rámy omluvěných vydaření. Pražská věsna byla bověn v řečivistošti kulmináciou dlouhotrvalých prób přeprovádzání reform, které měly obejmovat především kvestě ekonomičné, společné i političné. Namacálným důvodem těch tendencí byla neudaná reforma ekonomičná zaproponována přes Otešika. Praktičně neporušená kvestě rehabilitací po procesech političných z let 50. i 60. i v Řešče vzpomínána už kvestě slovácká, která zůstala zaktualizovaná v 68. roku při okázi přijenča nové ústavy regulujúcej funkcionované federácii. Oceňajúc interesujúce naše vydařenie z dlugofalovej perspektívy, zasadníčou role odegrála rovněž změna dajonca še a zaobservovať v šeregách samej partii, ktorá byla barzo masová. V ovým čase 2/3 členků v toho sobě, které v šeregy partii vstoupily do Piero po převroče z lutého 48. roku, Niměl Polová stala se členkami v počongu u předních děšonců lat. Značonca Čenč z nich naležala do vrstvy inteligenské i vykonývala práce umyslové. V výniku těch přeměn vzrostal ugulný požom, vykšel Čeň a partijnej bázy, co přikladalo vše na stupeň akceptací dla proponovaných reform partii. Istotnou role při mobilizování společenstva obyvatelského a takže při promování nového kierovnictva partijného v řečivistošti naleželo by radši mluvit o staronovém kierovnictve, poněvadž změny na přivůčích stanoviskách partii komunističnej byly bardzo povolné, odegrály látem 68. roku komunističní intelektuališči, ščegulně pisáře i dženikáře. Ludvík Vaculík v manifestě zatitulovaným 2000 slov, oglošeným v koncu červca 68. roku, zýval do kontinuování reform. Značonce je zpřítím, že kierovnictvo partii komunističnej odručilo tézy postavione v tým tekšče, uznajonce je za zbyt radikálne. Je to vymovný důvod na to, že vyobražání dotyčonce reform byly různorodné a časem v renč vzájemně vše vyklučajonce. V točených vůvčas diskuziách odnalešť možná šlády různorodných tradicí političných. V 68. roku v Čonč ještě žilo věle osů pamětajících časy předvojeny, které v zestavění s požnějšími okresami javili se jako zlatá epoka. Duže označení měl rovněž ukšaltovný už po vojně poglond, myšle kterého Čechoslovácia měla odgryvač role po mostu pomenzi vschodem i zachodem. Živo bylo rovněž vzpomínaně povstání vengerské, v jeho výniku praktičně v ogule nepojavil se v debatě publičnej postulat neutrálnosti. Jakýkoliv reformy měly dotýčit jedině kvěsti politiky ve vnitřní. Z prvotně plánovaných i představených květňů v programu Dželan Kápeče reform událo se v čongu těch nevělů myšonci pozostalých do času šerpňové invázy zrealizovat za ledvě kilka postulátů. Například na plaščížně legislacínej vzpomíná se v tým kontextě o dvou nových istotných ústávách. Příklad pierši dobře pokazuje, s jakými ograničeniami pražská věsna mušila šelíčiť, jak dalece možlivosti odbiegali od očekávání i naději. Ústava o rehabilitaci sondovej měla vše vedle preambuly odnosit výlučně do osob, které byly ofiarami a ne přečivníkami režimu komunističného. Co věncej, v procese rehabilitací jiným žádné role neměli odgrývat představitele novopostalého zvězku bílých věžňů v političních kád 231. Dělnost tego zvězku nikdy zresto nezostala zaakceptovaná přes ministerstvo správ vnitřních. Jak by tego bylo málo, ústava ta po invazi šerpňovej zostala zmíněna tak, že kromk osu podlegající rehabilitaci zostal ještě bardzo zavěžony. V efektě zamiast rehabilitaci obejmujúcej kilku dziesiąt tysiący pokřivdžonych došlo do procesu obejmujúcego zaledve ich ulámek okolo 1500 vňuskojúcich o rehabilitaci. Druhá ústava měla bardzo symboličný charakter i uznačuju náleží za největší sukces pražské vjostny v dědžině volnosti intelektuálné. Chodilo minoviče o novele práva prasového, v které v dož lakoniční formě znalezla vše gvarancia volnosti slova, sformulovaná jak nedopušťalnost jakýkoliv cenzury. V řeči listošti nadal funkcionovala autocenzura, některé tematy, ščegulně té dotyčonce politiky zahraniční, byly tématami tabu. Mimo to, likvidace cenzury byla fundamentálním ošungněčem pražské vjosny. Obě té novely právně popřed zóne byly přijentým ještě na počátku marca 1968 roku rozpořízením kierovnictva partijného, v myšlu kterého centrální úřad publikací vyloučený notabene z institucionálních rám ministerstva správy vnitřních měl možlivost uglošení a zakazu publikací vyloučně v situaci, kdy dochodilo do narušení tajemnice panstvovej. Odpovědělnost za publikované materiály měla spadač na redaktorů na čelných poštěgulných titulů, který byly zřešto použněji vykořistováni přes kierovnictvo partijné do pacifikování a zbyt zaangažovaných dženikáři. V efektě po vyšších změn od marca 1968 roku média začaly vyražný způsob oddělovat na opinie publičnou. Coraz čenštěji začaly se často pojavovat texty pošvěncované takým tématom, jako totalitárna přešlošť, problémy ekonomičné či navěc svobody obyvatelské zvězané s provazením politiky. Vydařeně té začaly kšaltovat společenstvo obyvatelské, obejmujonce v prvním řondě přežívajonce druga mlodož partie satelické, ale rovněž novopostajonce organizácie z toho řešenia. Svoje role odgryvalo rovněž zvětšené zainteresování koščolami i zvězkami vyznaniovými. V okreše tím dalše rovněž zauvazit i proces rozpadu do těch čas funkcionujících velkých masových organizací i rovněž masových institucí zvězkových. Te obřímě změny společně mohly očiviště ujišť uvádze z vjosku radžeckého i jiných panst sojuzničích, kde zrozumělých vzglendov zbudili one zmožonou čujnošť. Bardzo kritičný byl například první sekretář KCKPČ Vladislav Gomulka, který na spotkání představičelů v krajů socialističních v Varšavě, v Bratislavě, mluvil o kontrarevoluci nového typu. Pamětá tež naleží, že konzervatiští šukali sparče spozad granicami krajů, co našídlo se po marcu, kdy po aféře s generálem Janem Šejnou zrezignoval ze svojego stanoviska prezident Antonín Novotný i tím samým ztračil jakýkoliv vplyvy političné. Kierownictwo partii komunistycznej starało się ograniczyć przejawy swobód obywatelskich różnymi zakulisowymi działaniami. Od maja 1968 roku rozpoczęła się w mediach wielka kampania propagandowa wymierzona w bielych wieżnych politycznych, w których wykorzystywano materiały służb bezpieczeństwa. Kierownictwo partii komunistycznej starało się również powstrzymać próby reaktywowania socjalnej demokracji. Mimo iż w ramach partii komunistycznej istniały różne poglądy dotyczące programu reform, to jednak wszystkie środowiska zgadali się w kwestii stosunku do prób stworzenia opozycji politycznej, co zręcz to było motywowanie na kilka sposobów. Dla konzervatystów všecky tego typu tendence byly po prostu antisocialistične. Dla reformatorů za klíčovým problémem pozastával stosunek Moskvy do předprovádzáních reform. Z tego vlastně povodu Aleksandr Dubček ukryval navěd před svojimi nejbližšími spolupracovníkami coraz čenště ze strany Leonida Iliče Brežněva grožby intervencí, do které ostatečně došlo v srpnu 1968 roku. Bezprostředně jej povodem byl strach Moskvy před vynikami zjazdů KPČ, na kterým výrazně rysovala se porážka skřídla konzervativného. Invazie vojsk úkladu varšavského byla nejmenší operací vojskové v Evropě po zakončení druhé vojny světové. Paradoxálně v Čingu těch kilka dní, v traktě, kterých większość przedstawicielów partii komunistycznej przeciwstawiało się inwazji, partia komunistyczna zyskała większe wsparcie społecznie niż kiedykolwiek wcześniej w czasie swoich rządów. Wsparcie to było krótkotrwałe, wkrótce po kapitulacji Aleksandra Dubčeka i członków kierownictwa i dalších i jiných členků kierownictva partii komunističnej v čongu jejich porování v Moskvě, bověm rozpočal se proces normalizací. Po masových čistkách šeregy partii komunističnej musialo opustit okolo 500 000 členků. Zastosované rozvězání šilové označalo konec jakýchkoľvek reform oraz šípky povrut sovětského modelu spravování vlády. Ruch ten byl možlivý mezi jinými dlatego, že značná change političných změn nakršlených v okreše pražské věsny pozostala tylko na etapě plánů. Instituce, systém legislacíny i jiné elementy úkladu političného pozostaly nezměněné. Změnily se na tom jást ideály i tendencie intelektuální. Pozostával rovněž mýt pražské věsny, zarovno ten mýt, jak i ideály do dzisiaj ujmujo nie tylko ludzi, utoż samojących się z demokratyczną lewicą na całym świecie. Dziękuję.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And now our last speaker, and there will be a real challenge for me to say properly his surname. I would like to introduce you a professor Vladimir Luarsabishvili. Professor Luarsabishvili is from the archives of the Ministry of Internal Affairs of Georgia. He is the author of the book, The History of the Dissident Movement in Georgia, and also he is the co-author of the monography, The Repression of Poles During the Great Terror. This monography will be published in the Institute of National Remembrance. The professor will tell us about events which are probably little known in Poland. The title of his paper is Tbilisi Protest is in March 1956 and Formation of Political Opposition in Georgia. You have, of course, 20 minutes.
Thank you. First of all, let me thank the organizing committee for inviting me. And the topic of my speech is very important and forms part of the contemporary history of Georgia. And its importance, there are several reasons why this tragedy of 9 March Bloody Tbilisi is so important. According to official sources, 21 people were killed and 54 were wounded on this fatal night. However, on March 9, 1956, the Soviet Army shot and injured hundreds of demonstrators near the House of Communication in Tbilisi. Women and children who tried to run away from the demonstration were beaten and peaceful citizens were suppressed. The majority of people killed were high school and university students. The youngest victim of the tragedy was a 15-year-old Vareli Alavidze. Now I'd like to speak a little about the reason for the March 9 tragedy. And as in the majority of cases of tragedies in the Soviet Union, the reason again was Joseph Stalin. This is how it all started. In early 1956, Communist Party First Secretary Nikita Khrushchev took an interest in Stalin's activities. For this reason, he ordered Soviet officials to review the cases of those subjected to repression. It was clear that 3 years after Stalin's death, the Kremlin was preparing to break with the cult of the great leader. So Khrushchev's intentions were revealed. In February 1956, Anastas Mikoyan, the first deputy chairman of the Council of Ministers, gave a report at the 20th Party Congress. Mikoyan had been one of Stalin's closest men, but he was tasked by Khrushchev with denouncing the cult of personality. Also, he did not mention Stalin by name. Mikoyan's report astonished the audience. It's unexpectedly, on February 25, the delegates of the Congress were convened at a closed session. Nikita Khrushchev addressed to the audience his report, in which he denounced Stalin's crime, and which amounted to an indictment of Stalin, lasted for about an hour. I'm speaking about the famous speech of Khrushchev entitled On the Cult of Personality and Its Consequences. Also, Khrushchev's speech was sent as a sealed letter only to the party leadership around the Soviet Union. News of the anti-Stalinist report leaked to the people and soon became known throughout the Soviet Union. Stalin's merit was barely mentioned in the materials of the 20th Party Congress in the official press. The anniversary of Stalin's death, March 5, was approaching, and in Georgia, and especially in Tbilisi and in other big cities of the Republic, groups of people were preparing to mark this event. The situation in the capital was becoming increasingly tense. The area surrounding the Stalin monument, erected in the square near the Karl Marx Bridge, in 1939 became the epicenter of the events. At 3 p.m. on March 4, city residents began to gather at the Stalin monument, and by evening their number reached up to 1,000. An honor guard was formed of young people. The participants of this mourning ceremony recited poems devoted to Stalin and sang songs. The next day, the number of protesters reached 10,000. On March 5, a cacophony of car sirens and horns could be heard in the center of the city. Protesters appeared carrying Stalin's portraits. People in the street chanted slogans of Lenin, Stalin. More nationalist slogans could occasionally also be heard. The protests in the capital triggered similar demonstrations in other parts of the republic, such as Gori, Kutaisi, Batumi, and Sokhumi. According to documents held in the archive of the Ministry of Internal Affairs of Georgia, on March 6, 1956, the Georgian KGB sent a coded telegram to the Soviet KGB with the next text. Regarding the materials of the 20th Party Congress covered in the press, the Georgian KGB was told by informants that people disapprove of the reports delivered by the Communist Party because Stalin's merit was barely mentioned. The informants also report that school and university students were planning to mark the anniversary of Stalin's death. The crowds that gathered on March 4 at the Stalin Monument in Tbilisi developed into a large-scale demonstration. By evening, the number of protesters reached up to 1,000. The demonstrators recited poems, sang songs dedicated to Stalin, and made speeches. The young people organized honor guards. On March 8, at the demonstration near the Stalin Monument, 49-year-old Ruben Hipiani attracted the attention of the KGB with an anti-Soviet speech. Hipiani read aloud 11 paragraphs of anti-Soviet demands, including the resignation and arrest of the government and party leaders of Georgian Communist Party. He made the provocative and anti-Soviet statement that, on the front I threw bombs and destroyed our enemies. Now I wish I had bombs to throw at those who are trying to disgrace Stalin's name. On that date, Felice was half paralyzed. In order to relieve some tension, on March 9, a lead article was published in the Republican newspapers entitled The Third Anniversary of the Death of Stalin. State flags with memorial ribbons were hung on some buildings, but the demonstrators were not satisfied with this. They demanded that Stalin's name be immortalized. The anti-Soviet spirit and sense of civil disobedience continued to increase. By the evening of March 9, the situation in Tbilisi has escalated to the extreme. The demonstrators worked out a text calling on the youth of all the republics of the Soviet Union to support them. They decided to send telegrams throughout the Soviet Union. At 11 p.m., around 50 activists stormed the Ministry of Communication building. The police were unable to stop them. They tried to occupy the radio center and the telegraph in order to send a telegram to Moscow. Soon after, KGB officers and then military officers and soldiers appeared in the building. The activists began to leave the building in order to prevent the situation from escalating further. However, the news was relayed at the demonstration that the activists had been arrested at the House of Communication. After a few minutes, anxious people tried to enter the building. Soldiers of the Soviet Army took up defensive positions. Soon the soldiers opened fire, dispersing the unarmed demonstrators with bursts of machine gun fire. A tank came rolling up from the Lenin Square. Later, Soviet soldiers began violently dispersing the demonstrators by Stalin Monument on the embankment, even running after women and attacking them. By 2 a.m., only soldiers stood at the communication house and the city was under lockdown by the Soviet military. In the fall of 1956, the 10th and 11th graders Zviad Gamsakhurdia and Merab Kostava, inspired by the March events, formed a patriotic organization called Gorgasliani, together with their friends. On the morning of December 2nd, they posted proclamations on the Rustaveli and Plekhanovi avenues, main avenues of the capital. In 1961, the Soviet authorities dismantled the Stalin Monument, which had been at the center of the 1956 events. It was obvious and, however, paradoxical. During those events, the people expressed their desire for freedom through the love for Stalin. These events became a benchmark of the awakening of the people, as well as of dissident and nationalist movements. The authors of the proclamations posted on December 2, Zviad Gamsakhurdia and Merab Kostava, eventually became the leaders of the national movement. These renowned Georgian dissidents were arrested and sent into exile many times. The March events of 1956 were repeated on April 9, 1989, which in turn was followed by the breakup of the Soviet Union. On March 31, 1991, as chairman of the Supreme Council, Zviad Gamsakhurdia held a referendum on the restoration of Georgia's pre-Soviet independence, which was supported by 88% of the vote. On April 9, 1991, Georgia declared its independence. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you all for keeping the time. Ladies and gentlemen, and I'm opening the discussion. We are waiting for questions, comments, and things like that. I suppose we have more or less half an hour.
Najpierw jedno pytanie do wszystkich państwa. Alexis de Tocqueville napisał, że protesty, bunty, rewolucje wybuchają wtedy, kiedy system przechodzi proces liberalizacji. Wybitny socjolog amerykański McAdam pisze o structural opportunities, czyli sytuacji zmiany, pozytywnej zmiany systemu, która wywołuje reakcję społeczną. Ta reakcja społeczna wywołuje kolejną zmianę systemu i następuje taka spirala. Mam wrażenie, że wszystkie te bunty i protesty były związane z władzą, ponieważ ta władza się zmieniała. Nie wiem, czy się Państwo ze mną zgodzicie. To jest pierwsze pytanie. Drugie pytanie dotyczy referatu poświęconego rewolucji na Węgrzech. I tutaj będą dwa podpytania. Pierwsze, autorka referatu cały czas mówiła o powstaniu na Węgrzech. Może tak nie śledzę tego dobrze, ale chyba w literaturze anglosaskiej zawsze była rewolucja na Węgrzech, a nie powstanie. Czy jest coś, są jakieś nowe ustalenia w tym względzie mówiące o tym, że było to rzeczywiście powstanie i jak pani definiuje powstanie w odróżnieniu od rewolucji? I kolejne pytanie do pani, związane z tym, co pani powiedziała o tym, że ludzie mieli know-how, jak protestować, ponieważ byli wyszkoleni wojskowo, mieli military training, jak pani powiedziała, oraz oglądali filmy. I tu kolejny podpunkt. W literaturze dotyczącej buntów i protestów mówi się o takiej koncepcji znowu amerykańskiej autorki toolkit, czyli mówiąc po polsku takiej pudełka z narzędziami, kulturowego pudełka z narzędziami, które podsuwa pewne, i tutaj na przykład można się odwołać do Charlesa Tilly, pewne rytuały społeczne, repertuar zachowań. Otóż skąd mieszkańcy Budapesztu wiedzieli, że trzeba budować barykady? Mieli dłuższą pamięć roku 1848. Czy pamiętali o tym z 1945 roku? Skąd wiedzieli, jak się zachować? Albo inaczej, co to były za filmy, które oni oglądali, które tak wzorotwórczo oddziaływały na nich, że wiedzieli, jak to się robi? Dziękuję.
Directly, yes.
Yes, or no?
Yes,
now.
Yes, lady first.
If I may start, in 1953, the Tocqueville saying, if I may start, in 1953, the Tocqueville saying is very true for the events in the GDR, because it seemed like weakness for the people when the Soviet, when the new course was announced, because many of the Stalinist measures were taken back. So in this, that's what I said at the beginning, so in this moment, workers also said, well, if they've taken back all these other measures, why shouldn't they take back the work norms? So it's very true. It's just...
Thank you. The first question, I think it is important, the spiral itself, because in 1953, there was a kind of thaw, and then the regime hardened by the mid-1954-55. And of course, people thought, okay, we had something, why are we losing it again? And then there was the example of the Berlin events, and there was the example of the Polish events. And like I said in the beginning, the whole 56 was a year of upheaval. People discussed. People thought changes could be somehow made to happen. Of course, there was the 20th Congress, and I think what is important, that it wasn't simply a crisis of power in Hungary, but it was assumed, it was perceived that it was a crisis of power in the whole communist camp. So of course, these kind of events traveled. With respect to uprising revolution, it's always a debate. I use uprising because this is a more neutral term, to be frank with you about that, because in political science, we are trying to use terms which are neutral. There is actually a big debate in Hungary. It was used revolution by the opposition and counter-revolution by the communist regime, but today The left wing would still call it a revolution. The right wing will say it wasn't a revolution. Revolution by now seems to be a very left-wing thing. I do not mind using it actually, but I was just trying to be as neutral in my phrases as possible. With the respect to the other question about the films, funnily enough, they were Soviet films. That was on the agenda. That was in the movies during the 1950s. One of the house-to-house or urban guerrilla things might have come from the Stalingrad, the siege of Stalingrad. I mean, that's what they learned, how to fight from house to house. On the other hand, like I said, it's a debated question. Some historians claim that, yes, that contributed to their toolkit, their knowledge. Other people claim that it wasn't that useful, but it must have been at least theoretical knowledge of this kind of fight, because like I said, those people who did have some expertise in war did not really join this urban revolt, because they thought it was hopeless. The ones who were actually participating mainly were young people, so their that kind of knowledge were more theoretical than practical.
Já myslím, že Pražská věsna je očiviště taká paradoxální revoluce, dlatego, že to nie je očiviště revoluce, jak už na Česku, ale bo myslím, že bez ukreslení role partii komunistické kierovnictva Dubčekova role, která je paradoxální, i myslím, že za hranicami Čech nie je tak zjavná, jak v historiografii české, kde očiviště je ona bardzo vážná diskuzie o jeho šlabosti i o jeho myšle nechenti k přejavům odnoveného společenstva. Myslím, že nie je možlivé zrozumět normalizaci. Co stalo, že, či jak bylo možlivé, že ta normalizace byla tak šípka v Republice České. I myslím, že je to dlatego, že ta Pražská věsna očiviště trvala kilko měsíců i myslím, že partia komunistická byla bardzo konzervativná. Že to nebyla jakáž šíla revolucína, i myslím, že i mezi reformatorami převažáli lidi, kteří měli nechent k jakýž systémovým změnám typu demokracii zachodnej.
Well, thank you for interesting questions. I will try to summarize your questions and sub-questions very shortly. First of all, I want to say that for me, uprising and revolution are different things. Uprising is associated in my mind with democratic process more than revolution. So I think that revolution is more linked to power than uprising. I think that uprising may be due to bad social life, low salaries, violence of human rights, etc., etc. Meanwhile, revolution, in majority of cases, may have the goal to, may aim to receive the power, to reach the power. Because I don't believe in non-bloody revolutions. Because if in 20th century, in second part of 20th century, we have some processes that are called non-bloody revolutions, I don't think that it's the right terminology, because revolution without blood is not revolution, in my point of view. Meanwhile, uprising may be bloody, but it doesn't aim to receive some power, maybe exceptions, sure, from every rule, but generally, I think. That's all I wanted to underline between these two terms. Thank you.
Pan profesor Jerzy Eisler.
Najpierw co do tej rewolucji i powstania. Nie można abstrahować od tego, że w różnych językach to samo pojęcie ma różną konotację. Dla Polaków powstanie jest świętą nazwą. Zawsze łączy się z obcą władzą, co jest zrozumiałe także w Polsce rządzonej przez komunistów, że ta władza nie pochodziła z narodowego wyboru, tylko przyjechała na radzieckich czołgach w 1944-1945 roku. Stąd te biało-czerwone opaski, biało-czerwone flagi, cała ta otoczka, taka atmosfera właśnie insurekcyjna. I kiedyś pamiętam, jak rozmawiałem z moim węgierskim przyjacielem Janoszem Tischlerem, bo na Węgrzech jednak mówiono rewolucja 56 roku. I rozmawialiśmy, że to ma inny wydźwięk. Ja mówię, w takim razie powiedz mi, jak po węgiersku nazywa się rok 1848, żeby wyjść z komunistycznych ograniczeń. On mówi, rewolucja. Ja mówię, czyli Lajos Kossuth i to... Tak, to jest rewolucja. Okej. Okay. I tutaj można mieć tłumaczy z wielkim podziękowaniem, można znać języki, natomiast można się pomylić nie dlatego, że mu po prostu pewne słowa, no revolution to jest rewolucja, uprising to jest powstanie, no przetłumaczone z angielskiego na polski, z polskiego na angielski, ale o ile angielskie uprising ma dość neutralną wymowę, no to polskie powstanie jest tak naładowane emocją pozytywną, taką historyczną, tradycyjną, że my tego słowa nie używamy tak nieprzemyślanie na zasadzie, że gdyby dziś doszło w Polsce do strajków, do buntów ulicznych, czegoś takiego, nie chodzi mi o dziś dosłownie, 5 lat temu i za 5 lat, to nikt by tego nie nazywał powstaniem, ponieważ władza jest polska, pochodzi z wyborów, a nie jest obca przywieziona na czołgach. A druga rzecz, ubawiło mnie to pytanie o doświadczenia. Ja pozwolę się podzielić pewną obserwacją. Polacy mają w Europie opinię mistrzów w konspiracji, w jakichś takich powstańczo-partyzanckich tradycjach. Otóż w roku 1980, znaczy opowiadał to w roku 81, nieżyjący od lat wybitny polski prawnik, historyk prawa, profesor Franciszek Ryszka, jak na uniwersytecie, a raczej w akademiku Uniwersytetu Wrocławskiego, wszedł do swoich studentów, a ci rozmawiali, jak to jesień 80 roku, kiedy na Zachodzie pisano wejdą, nie wejdą, początki Solidarności, jak oni będą robić butelki z benzyną i rzucać w radzieckie czołgi. Na co profesor Ryszka, który był w czasie II wojny światowej frontowym żołnierzem pierwszej Armii Wojska Polskiego, mówi, nie butelki, to ma być kamionka. Kupuje się miód, miód się wylewa, wlewa się benzynę i zrobił instruktaż, jak robi się taki koktajl Mołotowa, prawdziwy, klasyczny. Profesor prawa. Żeby podkreślić. To tyle. Dziękuję bardzo.
Oh, thank you. First of all, I would like to thank you for those very useful information on the Molotov cocktail issue. You never know. And second, just to add to the confusion, there is a part in Hungarian politics, historical approach, which doesn't use revolution or uprising, but uses freedom fight. Because, and that's really a question of shades and what you would like to emphasize. And your distinction is interesting and I will consider it, because the question with respect to 56 is more and more, do we look at it as a revolution, which in the original sense of the time meant, and the people, the participants, did call themselves revolutionaries, and the idea meant that they would like to continue the left-wing change, but in a different way than the Stalinist solution. On the other hand, others like emphasizing the freedom fight aspect, the anti-Soviet aspect. However, I would argue that it was present from the beginning, partly because one of the inspirations for the revolution uprising was that looking at the Austrian state treaty of 1955, people, Hungarian people thought, okay, if the Russians could withdraw from Austria, maybe we can persuade them to do the same with respect to Hungary. And among those 16 points I was talking about, one of them was that Russian troops might just depart, and we shouldn't give the Hungarian old Soviet Union. So there were a bunch of sovereignty, freedom fight issues there from the very beginning.
I'd like to add something to this discussion. I think it's very important first to define revolution and what we mean by it. Otherwise, we're going to talk. we can't talk properly. I think the definition which Charles Tilly gave was very useful, because he said there needs to be a revolutionary situation, there needs to be a revolutionary idea, and there needs to be a dramatic change. And we have to analyze each situation if these characteristics apply. And before this background, I also use the term uprising for the events in 1953 in the GDR, because a dramatic change was not what was had in the end. And that there is, of course, in the other debated question, if a revolution has to be violent or bloody. I would say not necessarily, because otherwise we couldn't call it the peaceful revolution of 1989 in East Germany, in Czechoslovakia, revolutions. But.
Czy jeszcze mamy kogoś, kto chciałby zabrać głos? W takim razie oddaję głos organizatorom.
Tak, bardzo dziękuję państwu referentom z zagranicy, również prowadzącemu doktorowi Marcinowi Kruszyńskiemu. Brawa dla państwa.